Indo-United States relations. We're delighted to have the Ambassador of India with us. India has been of enormous interest to the United States since it began its major interest in foreign affairs in 46, 47, India being founded and gaining its independence, at least, in 47. And our relations have taken on many forms, as you all know. We've thought of India as a showcase of democracy. We've been disappointed sometimes with their independent postures during the Cold War. Their great friendship with the Soviet Union at the end of the period of time of the Soviet Union was not always happy for the United States. But we've always respected the Indian positions, which have invariably been intelligently and eloquently presented. India has what I think was the third largest army in the world today. Maybe it's the second today, but in any case, it's a major military force, second largest country in the world, as all of you know, and certainly destined, already a great power, to be one of the very great powers in the 21st century. And so we're deeply interested in India and in India's view of the world, in which she plays such a major role. Our guest tonight, Ambassador Chandra, is a career civil servant. He entered the Indian Civil Service in 1956. He became, he reached the highest post within that civil service in 1990, retiring as its senior civil servant in 1992. The positions he held covered the full range on the levels of state government in India. And on the federal government, he was secretary to the ministries of water resources and of home, our interior, and defense. And after his retirement, he served as a senior advisor to the prime minister and a governor of one of the states of India. He also, incidentally, served with the Commonwealth for a short period of time during his civil service career. So it's been a wonderfully rich career in which he has excelled and reached the very top, and we're delighted to welcome him this evening as the ambassador of his nation to the United States. Ambassador Chandra.
Dr. Bird, President of the Council, ladies and gentlemen, I am very grateful to the Council on Foreign Affairs for this opportunity and inviting me to the beautiful city of Baltimore. I am getting a better view of the city, I am sure, than you are. I am sorry I couldn't come earlier. There were one or two occasions when I had to rush on some assignment, and I apologize for the inconvenience caused to your council. The subject of today's talk is very timely for two reasons. One, that today's function happens to be taking place in during the course of our 50th year of independence and freedom and democracy. And so we are at a stage when we are not only celebrating what we have achieved during the last 50 years, but also going through a period of self-examination and introspection as to what the deficiencies have been and the challenges that we still have to meet. So this opportunity gives me this function gives me the opportunity to explain some of our policies, invite your comments. When there is a question and answer session, please feel free to tell me where you disagree or you have a different point of view, and I'll try my best to offer an explanation. The second point is that never before have we had such a distinct improvement in India-US relations as during the last 3 or 4 years. And it is best to dwell on this development, the present state of our relations, and the importance that both sides attach to it would be evident from the fact that we have started having very important visits to each other's country, and discussion has begun. Apart from the interaction we have been taking at a operational level between key officials, we had the good fortune of a meeting between the two heads of governments in September at New York, just to formalize the ground rules for carrying on a very serious strategic dialogue between India and the USA. This has been set up after a very carefully prepared agenda, which was discussed at the level of our Foreign Secretary and Undersecretary for Political Affairs here. And the conclusions of the brief discussions that took place between our Prime Minister and the President has helped to pave the way for future interaction. I'm leaving tomorrow for Delhi to be in time for the meeting planned between the Secretary of State and our Prime Minister in New Delhi. That would be followed by a visit by Commerce Secretary Daley, Secretary Shalala, and then ending with the visit of the President, hopefully, by end of February and early March. So I can safely assert that the state of relations between India and US are very good, despite the bumps we have had along the way. To discuss this subject further, I think I have to go back to 1946 and deal with some of the points indicated by our President this evening as to why we had a difference of opinion on a number of issues. But before I come to the points of disagreement, I must say that away from a lot of public attention, there has been a large area of agreement and cooperative effort between agencies in the United States and India, but they do not get sufficiently publicized. And what we view always is the tip of the iceberg, the area of the disagreement, and what lies below the surface is generally not seen. Some of you will be knowing that much of the achievement which took place in development work, quite a bit was as a result of cooperation between entities from US and India. If you take agriculture, you will find that when we became independent, we had a problem, a very acute food problem. We had not only food shortages during the war, but we had one of the worst famines in Asia in 1942, the Bengal famine. And it is talked about still. But the fact is that we, within the first 20 years, were able to look after our food security. And by the late 60s, the results of the Green Revolution was apparent. And now we have a situation where India, despite its burgeoning population, is a net exporter of food. And people say that despite further increases, which we are trying to check very sincerely, it will continue to be a net food exporter for some time. The main research effort which came, which is responsible for this happy development, is as a result of very close collaborative research between American scientists and Indian scientists. In the field of energy, as many of you know, the first atomic reactor came from the United States. In the area of technology and technical education, we gave up the British pattern of higher education and switched both in the sphere of agriculture education, and while establishing the institutes of technology, we followed the American pattern. And that has helped us in providing a very large resource pool of trained people in technical subjects and also through the institutes of technology. For some time, there has been a adverse consequence of this, because we found that about a third of the best graduates from the institutes of technology migrated outside, mostly to United States. And there was some concern that this brain drain would affect our prospects adversely. But what has happened now is that these graduates from IITs and other technical institutions who are working in United States and other countries have proved to be not only bridges of understanding, but have helped promote more business and technology collaboration between US and India or any country where they were settled. Also in the area of satellite communication, the first system came from United States. I remember when I was in the Ministry of Industry and we had a nice control and licensing regime going then, nice for bureaucrats. We had the largest number of applications from Indian companies pertaining to collaboration and technical collaboration with firms in the United States. So this preference for American technology has always been there in India. Now, what is it that has hampered the growth of relations during the Cold War is a matter which has to be viewed in the historical context. It is true that the policies which had to be followed in the 50s did result in a closing of the Indian market. So the potential that existed in terms of international trade and promoting more commerce across the world between India and other countries did not come to pass. So in that sense, there has been a great disadvantage. But what we have to view is that India of 1947 was really something. It is something to study, because we were in a country which had practically remained outside the pale of the Industrial Revolution. For 100 years, Indians viewed industry as something that existed abroad. And the products of those industrial enterprises were imported into India and sold at the expense of people working in the decentralized sector. Cloth, for instance, it had to be woven. Despite the few spinning mills we had, there were hundreds of thousands of weavers and textile workers in the rural areas who were totally hit when the Lancashire mills started sending the cloth to India. The same is true for other class of goods. So in 1947 and 50s, the political leaders had a certain view of industry, and that persisted for a number of years. Industrial units were seen as something external and as instruments of exploitation. The second was that government found that if we continue to have an open market policy, it will not be possible quickly to establish such industry, including basic and heavy industry, which was necessary to provide a certain framework and infrastructure where Indian companies could then compete on equal terms with companies from outside. And lastly, there was an attempt to very quickly create a class of entrepreneurs, managers, people who could run industry. So when we say that India went for planning, what we have to realize is that it never went in for a socially controlled economy of the type that came out of the Soviet Union or countries of East Europe or in China. I say this with good cause, because if you reflect, you will find that all of agriculture, 99% of it, remained in private hands. Land belonged to the tiller. We carried extensive land reforms. And agriculture sector, which accounted for more than 2/3 of the people engaged in any economic activity, and which was a very large chunk of our GDP, was always private and has remained private. Trade, all trade except in strategic material and petroleum, which we have to import, was always in private hands. Even when we went and set up public sector in many areas, vast sums of taxpayers' money were spent to support private companies, private initiative in the small scale and the medium scale sector. If an analysis is done of the manner in which budget rupees were spent, you will find that there was a whole lot of activity which just cannot take place in a socially controlled economy. And I assert this point to rebut the very superficial charge which is often thrown as if we were on a Soviet model. India was never on a Soviet model. It was on its own model. But the fact remains that in having to follow this policy for right or wrong reasons, we suffered a disadvantage in the sense that our interaction with the more developed economies suffered. And India's share in world trade, which was about 2.5% when we became independent, dwindled to as low as 0.5%. After 91, when we have liberalized the economy, it has started to rise up, but it's still not 1% of world trade. And this is a factor which has been taken note of, and we are trying to correct in many ways. The other aspect, this was on the business, trade, and industry side, why our interaction with Western economies and United States remained limited during the Cold War. The second aspect arises out of the compulsions of the geopolitical situation in which India finds itself. Ever since independence, India found large disputed borders to the west and to the north. In fact, it is difficult to find a neighbor with whom we did not have some kind of border dispute or another. You will be surprised that one existed between Sri Lanka and India also. Although we are separated by 20, 30 miles of water, but where that line should be and who owned which island was also a matter of dispute. Now, in such a situation, security concerns, because disputes often resulted into conflict, one did in our northwestern border, and by 1962, we were involved in another conflict with China. The result was that taking advantage of this situation, right from the early 60s, a kind of alliance developed between China and Pakistan. And since both are our neighbors, it is something which cannot be, the importance of that could not be minimized. There was an attempt in 62 to improve and strengthen and deepen defense security relations with the United States. But after the ceasefire, the thing didn't progress very far. But in 1965, after the death of Prime Minister Nehru, that could be a reason. That plus the fact that the Indian Army was still recovering and regrouping after the 1962 conflict with China, there was an attack on our western border. And that was a very serious one. And in 1965, actually, first in 62 and then in 1965, India realized that what defense security really is. And we could not help giving heed to very serious counsel from friends which was coming that we had been neglecting the defense sector. And the amount of money which we were spending on India's defense was grossly inadequate. That was one. Second, that we have to go in for strategic relationships and work out how to counter the alliance, spoken and unspoken, which had developed between two of our neighbors. And as a result of this, anybody who seriously studies the situation to the north and west of India would realize that even the most ordinary intelligence would discover that India had no option but to have some kind of an alliance with the Soviet Union, because Soviet Union had its own border problems with China. And in going in for that friendship, the result was that we were able to avoid a level of defense expenditure which it would not have been possible to avoid if that agreement had not been done. I have used the word alliance very loosely. There never was a India-Soviet alliance in a military sense, but it was a kind of a friendship treaty requiring both countries to consult each other in times of need. But the idea was to send a message to our neighbor to the north and to the west that you are not free to combine to the disadvantage of India's security concerns. And that is where the matters remained. To the end of the 80s, that situation persisted in one form or the other, but I have dwelt enough on the past. The fact is that from 90s, a new chapter opened suddenly in two ways, because for very solid reasons, we took a policy decision that we have to de-license industry, liberalize the economy, totally liberalize the trading regime, and also review all our options in the post-Soviet Union situation after the dissolution of the Soviet Union. And the result is that today when we review all these factors, we find that something which should have taken long ago, coming together of India and USA for very solid reasons, and over a period of time we had missed a number of opportunities, that now the time was absolutely ripe to engage each other in very serious negotiations, and that is the stage at which we are. What are the areas of agreement and disagreement? That would be important to review. I don't have to detail very much what we have in common. They are very well known. The fact is that there are quite a number of factors which bring us closer together. One is absolute faith in democracy, the highest importance attached to individual liberty and freedom, a total commitment to free press and an independent judiciary. These are some of the factors. And on the social side, the type of family values that the people have in both countries, the tolerance to all religions, a multilingual, multi-ethnic society. All these are factors which have very often led people to remark that India and US seem to be two democracies divided by a common set of goals, and something has to be done about it. On the flip side, we have first a difference in approach. For various reasons, India has not been able to follow policies which are fully consistent with market economics. And that is so for reasons which are very, very Indian. It is not only that in a theoretical way we are going by certain doctrinaire principles written in one book or the other. That has not been the case at all. But what we have to see are the realities of India. We have a very mixed type of situation. I have said it before that for India, you can say something very positive and you will be substantially correct. And you can say precisely the opposite and you will still be correct. And that is the set of contradictions which face the political leaders or the planners. Take education, for instance. We take great pride that we have produced or reached a level where we can produce a 250,000 technical graduate scientists and doctors every year, that we have more teachers in colleges today than the total number of students in colleges when we became independent. For every Chinese person going to college, there are six Indians going to college. But when it comes to literacy and elementary education, then again the figures change. We are behind our neighbors, we are behind China, and we have a mixed type of situation that while we have a very large pool of scientists, doctors, engineers, and many of them come outside, some are flourishing in the United States, we also have almost a fourth of all illiterate people of the world. We have a burgeoning middle class, close to 250 million, exerting its pressure on the market, demanding better goods, better services. But we have 200 million people who are living in conditions of poverty. We have some of the best surgeons, very good hospitals, heart transplants, all kinds of operations are performed, but we have backward areas where elementary health services are not available. So it's a problem for the planners, and it's a political and social problem. In the government of India and the government of these states are not able to just concentrate on the rate of growth at which the economy must develop. We have constantly to see what this development process has in store in the short run for the more vulnerable sections of the Indian society. Because it is only the rich and the healthy who can take a long-term view. The poor and the sick cannot take a long-term view because for them priority one is survival. What's going to happen next month? What's going to happen tomorrow? What they are going to eat tonight? Now to these people, government cannot produce a plan which gives very good figures, 7%, 8% rate of growth, when they will have a year or so of even greater hardship. That kind of line cannot be sold. Even politically, we have analyzed that when democratic parties are not able to sell a plan which economic experts would endorse, because it increases pain or does not relieve hardship in the short run, it is not only because of the votes of the poor. Any government, any political party which is seen as anti-poor or not fully sympathetic to their problems does not get even in the, does not get votes and support even among the well-off sections. And this is a lesson which the political parties cannot forget. And it is for this reason that parties say that we will have to take that option which doesn't increase pain and which tends to reduce hardship in the short run, even if it means sacrificing one or two percentage points or of in terms of rate of growth and so on. So this is a very strong factor that has to be taken note of when we discuss the economic policies. From 91, many of you who have been visiting India, and I find some of the corporate members of this council have established their presence in India, they would know that despite all the ups and downs that we have had, today the position in India is that the financial management of the last 4 or 5 years has brought a situation where fiscal deficit is under control. It's been brought below 5%, and the aim is to bring it to 4 and then to 3.5. Inflation, which was running at about 17% in 91, was quickly brought down to 6, now it is below 4%. We have reserves of close to $30 billion. In 91, we were down to $1 billion. So the position in the last 4 or 5 years has shown quite a number of things. One is that as a result of the protection or encouragement which Indian industry got, even by opening the market, most of them have been able to survive. The argument can be reversed upon the government. Why did you take so long? If you had done it 10 years earlier, you would have been much ahead by now, and there is great force in this argument. I feel, and quite a number of us feel, that we took several years more than we need have to open up the market, de-license industry, and trust industry. But I must say there are two views on that. There are a number of industrial units which did not close down and survived in the 90s, but I was in the Ministry of Industry. I'm not so sure that they would have survived 10 years ago. Economists can say, but that's a good thing. The inefficient must go to the wall. But they have also to realize that what would have happened to the workers, because the taxpayers don't finance a welfare safety net in India. We don't have that scheme. So countries have to choose whether the shareholders bear that burden or the taxpayers bear that burden. And in India today, the situation is that it's largely the shareholders which have to bear this burden of social security for the workers. But the point I would like to get back to, that by the 90s, the situation has been that Indian industry has been able to withstand competition. And even though our tariff rates have been brought down from as high as 260% in some cases and 100% in most cases, now the maximum import duty which can be charged on any class of products is 40%. And that is also very high. It is applied to certain class of consumer goods, but not to equipment, instruments, or whatever is required for important areas. The other major development which has taken place, where we have been able to strengthen relations, is on the investment side. For the first time in the 90s, the doors were open to foreign investment. And I'm glad to be able to say that it is the U.S. Corporations which have been in the lead. And today the position is that the largest investor in India is United States, and the largest trading partner, the first trading partner of India, is also the United States. And this is as a result of many factors. It's not only that English language is there or the people have been going back and forth in colleges and training institutions, but I think it's a bit more than that. There is a certain complementarity which many industrial enterprises and commercial houses have discovered. And we feel that in many areas of infrastructure where large sums of investment are required, the US corporations and entities and financial institutions are comparatively much better placed than their counterparts in other countries. If I just give the bare outlines, in infrastructure, our modest aim today, I say modest because it is nowhere meeting the demand, is that we must drum up at least $10 billion of foreign investment in the next 10 years. This $100 billion would then be also not enough when combined with the resources which can be mobilized in India. In say, power sector, in power alone, the requirement is close to $60 billion. For roads, the requirement is another $50 to $60 billion. For telecom, I am told that if we go to the world average, not very high, just the world average, it requires about $70 billion. Now, these are figures of investment which cannot possibly be mobilized in the Indian market. And it is for this reason that in the area of infrastructure, all controls have been relaxed. And in most of these areas, up to 100% foreign equity is available. Shares can be purchased in Indian companies. But in existing companies, to prevent quick takeovers of corporations for some time, limits of 10% or 20% or 30% have been placed. But I'm quite sure over a period of time that would also go. The hurdles standing in the way of greater investment and industrial relations between our two countries are constantly under review. Most of them have been removed. There are two or three areas which I will mention. But on the financial services side, there are differences on how we view the WTO regime. There are differences, if I could just recount them. One relates to intellectual property rights. But here we find that there is quite a bit of misunderstanding in this area. If I could briefly explain, first is, insofar as copyright is concerned, Indian law and standard of enforcement is as good as anywhere else. And that takes care of a lot of intellectual property matters, including computer software. When we come to patents, the problem is not across the board, but only in relation to product patents and process patents. In India, process patent is available. In US and other countries, the entire product is patented. And this is the main reason why we have had ongoing disputes in the area of drugs and pharmaceuticals. The whole problem has now got limited to this point and in the area of drugs and pharmaceuticals. But since we are committed to the WTO regime, it is also a diminishing problem. In the next 5-6 years, it will be a thing of the past. The second dispute relates to QRs, quantitative restrictions. We have had tremendous protection for agricultural products and certain classes of consumer goods where we do not want the demand to go totally askew and to prevent money going into sectors which still in India are not considered very desirable. Except for this class of items, all others have been taken off the category of QRs. But the time required for it, many countries, even countries like France and Japan, they have taken a number of years to hit the farm sector or the agriculture sector. India is settling down to 6. The point we are trying to urge is that we are using QRs, even though we have $30 billion, for two reasons. One, that we do not want the whole process to get a bad name. If we generate a lot of resentments against globalization, against more trading and liberalized trading, somewhere or the other, we will have to pay a price for it in terms of local resistance and time wasted. So we are saying once the direction is clear, it's a question of 1 or 2 years. We have to exercise patience and not go for the kill and create a problem which can be managed today just by a little more patience. The second point is that the reserve looks very big, but we have to see how much of it is loan, how much of it is deposits held by foreign individuals and institutions who can call it back anytime they wish, as countries in South Asia have found to their cost, Thailand, Malaysia, Philippines, Indonesia, and the amount of loan which Indian entities have taken and they now have to repay in foreign exchange, even though they will be making money in rupees. So the Reserve Bank of India has to watch out for all this. And we have had any number of scares. We have had good foreign exchange balances and seen them evaporate suddenly. We have seen a situation where continuously over 3 years, a slow hemorrhage takes place and the foreign exchange keep coming down. So the government of India's view of the $30 billion that we have got has to be viewed in this context. Plus, the criticality of imports. The imports that we have, it's very difficult to cut down because more than a quarter of all imports is just oil. So there's no way of cutting it down. Then you have to import fertilizer. We are the largest importers of fertilizers in the world. Now, you can't cut it down. You cut it down, your food production goes down. Then you get newsprint from outside, paper. You don't get it, your trees go. Or the newspapers will say, where is my right of free speech? I can't get paper to print my newspaper. So the thing is so difficult to manage that in India, import compression measures are not very feasible. You do that and you hit either industry, you hit the press, you hit the farmer. Because the spectrum of luxury exports or avoidable, luxury import or avoidable import is very, very small. And it is for this reason that we have to be very careful of how we view our foreign exchange. And this has resulted, this is another point of disagreement between India and US on the trade and industry side. Insurance sector, in financial services, we have a problem because first we have to denationalize. And here the finance minister and the government are tackling the workers' associations to arrive at an arrangement where we first privatize insurance. Because only after privatizing it, then we can get the foreign companies into the field. But I am told on good authority that within this month, the bill is going to be moved, which would pave the way for cutting in the private sector into insurance, starting with the health sector. On the security side, there are just two or three points of difference. One is on non-proliferation. Now, how non-proliferation is viewed in USA is quite from a different standpoint than how it is viewed in India. Because we have a, in US, when people say that there should be non-proliferation and the weapons of mass destruction should not be allowed to proliferate, it's very good policy. Because we are talking from a position of strength, we have got it. And since we have got it and we are strongly of the view that we'll use it to noble purpose, we are equally strong in the opinion that others should not spend money on it, and if they have it, too many people will have it, and so on. In our case, we have two neighbors who have got it. China has got it, and China is not 10,000 miles away. If you ask Indians about upgradation of weapons or nuclear arsenal in US, they don't bother. You can double your warheads. India is not concerned. But if there is enhancement to our north, that's a cause of major concern. And what we are saying is that here are a billion people who have started to develop, who in terms of purchasing power parity, not my term, World Bank's term, are already amongst the first five or six economies of the world. That if we progress at the rate we are expected to, not that we are saying we will progress, financial institutions are saying, this is where India will be in 2010, this is where India will be in 2020. According to them, we are going to be among the first five and six in the next 20, 30 years. And that is at the rate of 7%. Professor Jeffrey Sachs says that he sees no reason why it can't be 9%. Now, we are talking of a major economy here, a major economy and a billion people in 20 years from now. They will be the only major economy who would not have either nuclear weapon or an umbrella protection of a nuclear power. Now, I would like any government to explain this to the people of India, that this is a good situation to be in. And this is the point that we have been trying to explain to the United States and other nuclear weapon states. And When I came here in April 96, in April of last year, this is the first subject I had to deal with. But I must say that amongst all the nuclear weapon states, India found maximum understanding here in Washington. And it is a result of the understanding shown here, including the ACDA, which is a very powerful and committed body, that we were able to manage this difference extremely well. And we did not allow it to burden or strain the fast improvement which was taking place in India-US relations. It's a very long subject. One can talk about it for hours on end. But the only point I will make is that India supports non-proliferation. It always has. The word was coined by an Indian diplomat. The first call for a CTBT was made by Pandit Nehru. But unfortunately, it is 40 years later that we got a return phone call that, look, you guys were talking about CTBT. How about concluding a treaty? But never mind that during this period, we have done another 2,000 tests, and you have done only one. But let's come now and agree to stop all that. Despite that, the Indian side continued to work with US and other nuclear weapon powers. But the ultimate breaking point came not as a result of US action, but the initiative taken by Russia, China, and United Kingdom. When at the last minute in June 96, they introduced a provision that this treaty will not come into force unless the following, which in effect means unless India signs, it will not come into effect. We had said we are not going to sign, which meant our agreeing to a draft which would never take off, because we had said and told Parliament that we will not sign the CTBT. And we were asked to agree to a draft which said that this treaty would be of no effect till India signs. So at this stage, we found ourselves in a splendid isolation. But as I keep saying all the time, that if any party feels that on a subject no light is being thrown and we are entering a dark arena, and many of us feel that we are, because the regime which the world and the people of the world are being asked to adopt is that if you conduct a test even in your laboratory and you abort it to within 10 kilograms, equivalent to 10 kilograms of explosion of TNT, it would be a treaty violation, an international offense. But if you feel, or a nuclear weapon state feels, that my security is threatened and my sovereign interests are involved, then you can go take a powerful hydrogen bomb and drop it on a population center, and it would not be an offense. This is the regime today. The entire impact of NPT, CTBT, if it comes into force, is that conducting a measly test is an offense, but dropping a hydrogen bomb on a city is not an offense. And I think that India is committed that somewhere at least one candle will remain lit till this position is not rationalized to the satisfaction of the people all over the world. But what we have urged notice is that the crippling effect it is having on the technology relationships between India and US has to be managed. US agrees that India, even though it has not signed NPT and the CTBT, has exercised extraordinary restraint. We have the capacity to conduct tests. We have not done it. But our scientists and our leaders felt that at least once we must show that our scientists are capable and we have the technological strength of conducting a test, which we did. Even though we have the capacity, the facility to do it again, by a unilateral decision and a self-denying ordinance, We have not done it before, ever again. By these two acts, we have shown that when it comes to restraint, even though we have not signed the NPT or the CTVT, we are the perfect adherents to every provision of this treaty. There are people who have signed these treaties who have violated it. So here is a situation where in its conduct of relations or technology collaboration or passing or setting up of nuclear stations, US finds itself in a position where it actively aids and encourages a power which has violated NPT with cooperation. But a power which has never violated, which has never been caught either for clandestine acquisition or clandestine transfer of nuclear technology to any other nation, is not allowed to trade with US entities or to have any kind of technological collaboration in the nuclear area. It is this difference that we are trying to manage, and I must say that today there is great optimism that when we engage in a series of discussions on strategic issues, we will concentrate on that and see that these hurdles, the last few hurdles in our technology relationships, are removed. Because when we engage each other in cooperation in industry and trade, the thing would be that if high-tech area gets cut off, then the full potential of India-US collaboration in this area would not be. I have not covered many subjects. Kashmir I have not touched, it's nearing 7 o'clock. I have not touched China. So there is anything you feel I have not covered or you have a different, please feel free, I must stop here and allow you, if you please come here, then we can have a...
Well, thank you for a marvelous and thorough overview. And miraculously, there are even some topics we didn't get covered. The question is, do you see a connection between Pakistan's nuclear program and the Kashmir question? And if the abandonment of your nuclear program or Pakistan's nuclear program were the price for a referendum, or rather a self-determination vote in Kashmir, would you be open to that?
I'll try to answer this shortly. You see, while there is some impact and some relationship between the two, there is no organic link. Because we are talking India's position in Asia and the world. And of that, India-Pakistan relation is a very small subset. The total security, the defense security or national security of India is not governed by India's relations with Pakistan or the limited dispute in Kashmir. The fact that even today, if Pakistan was to fold up and dismantle all its nuclear establishment, India will not give up the nuclear option. This has to be fully understood. The second point which has to be understood is that the defense expenditure which is taking place in India is less than 2.5% of GDP. We spend 1/4 of what China spends. We spend more than Pakistan, but Pakistan spends 7% of its GDP on defense. In terms of per capita defense expenditure, and as a proportion of its GDP, the expenditure in India is the lowest. We are committed to enhancing the defense security mechanism of India to a more respectable level. And I explain it to many people that this assumption that if India-Pakistan relationship improve, it will help India to divert money, it's not going to happen. The expenditure on defense will keep going up because we have other neighbors and we have to see what they are doing, where their economies are going, what their armament acquisition is like and how they are behaving in our waters and close to our borders. So this is the point which has to be understood.
The question is, where does India stand on the Iraq question today, and how do you see the eventual resolution?
India has taken the stand from the very beginning that what happened in the state of Kuwait was plain wrong, and we said it. Then we have also not been outside the course of action which was approved by the UN system or the UN Security Council, and that is where we stand. We don't have a view independent of our own on this. We are with the world community.
The Enron disaster and or a problem and your view of it.
Well, you see, Enron was a victim of a set of circumstances which occurred coincidentally. Enron Corporation was the first to come forward, and since they had a very comprehensive program and a very large project, when the energy cost came out, there was a bit of concern where the Indian consumer or Indian industry would be able to pay 2 rupees or more per unit of power. We were used to 1 rupee or less. Then the other thing was that politically it came at a bad time. The government which signed the agreement took a lot of political credit. And since they tried to say that it's a very good deal, on the eve of the general election, the opposition party said it's a bad deal, and it's the opposition party which won. So both sides were in a problem, and these guys had told the electorate that if we come to power, we'll review. And to their surprise, they did come to power, and they were forced to review despite the advice given by civil servants and experts. Well, it took time, but you have to divide the litigation that Enron went through in two parts. One was, which could be called as politically motivated, and that was avoidable, but it occurred as a result of party politics in the state of Maharashtra. But the fact is that courts went deeply into the question, and within a few months, they were able to hand down judgments favorable to Enron Corporation each time. The second set of litigation was on environmental concerns, and that can happen anywhere. You ask any authority setting up power utilities, and they will tell you how difficult it is to get through the environmental concerns and sort of successfully come out of the litigation. But the good feature is that although some time was wasted, Enron Corporation found that this is a place you can do business with and get remedies, legal and judicial remedies, in a fair manner. So they are committed to this project. This project is on track. It is going to start producing power in 18 months from now. And Enron, as a result of this experience, have announced another $5 billion of investment program in India.
Mr. Ambassador, it's been a marvelously informative evening, and we certainly enthusiastically wish you well. Thanks so much.